around me. Oh Lord.
And then take part in our Bible study. Thank you, Lord. We're actually going to come from. Oh, just a minute. Let me get my computer back up here. We're going to come from Matthew's chapter 5, verse 43. We're basically going to talk about the love of God. We're going to talk about love a little bit. In Matthew's chapter 5, verse 43, let us pray as we get into the Word of God. Amen. Father God, we thank you tonight. We thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit. And Father God, your Word said that where there are two or three of us gathered in your name, that you would be a God in the midst of us. And Father God, we thank you tonight for being in the midst of us. Father God, I pray that you would, amen, that you would bless us tonight with your presence. I pray that your Holy Spirit, amen, would be here tonight, Father God. And I pray that as this word go forth, Father God, that we'll not just be hearers, we'll be doers, Father God. I pray that this word will transform our hearts, our character, that, Father God, that we may walk in the fullness of Christ Jesus. And Father God, I thank you and I honor you for today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I just want to thank the Lord for another opportunity of us coming together to fellowship and to lift up the name of Jesus. Amen. I was looking at something. Now, say go to Matthew chapter 5, verse 43. It's actually what we're going to start at. But I was looking at something earlier today, and I just want to add this in before I read Matthew's, because we got the purpose of ministry is, first of all, it's to perfect us. The word perfect in the Greek is teleos. The word perfect means to complete, to make whole. You know, and so the purpose of fivefold ministry is to perfect us, to make us whole. How many know that we are incomplete without God?
Amen.
Amen. We don't really have true life without God. Uh-huh. Amen. It's kind of like a plant or a tree. If the limb fall off, it'll live for a while, but eventually it'll die. That's not true life. But in order to have true life, you got to be connected to the vine. Amen. You got to be connected to God. And so the purpose of fivefold ministry is to bring us into the fullness of who God is and of who we are in Christ Jesus. Now, I know those are powerful words. I know when people hear words like that, they look at the preacher, because many religious people don't make those kind of statements to say that the Word of God comes to complete you and to make you like your Heavenly Father. And we're going to find out tonight, and you probably already know it, that love actually makes us like God. Because that's who God is. God is love. And we as the church, we're supposed to demonstrate love. How many know that there shouldn't be no hatred? There shouldn't be no bitterness? There shouldn't be no unforgiveness in the heart of a born-again saint of God? That we're supposed to walk in love toward all men. The scripture said we're supposed to redeem the time. It's our job to go out and redeem. It's our job to go out and reconcile. It's our job to show people the love of God. Amen. You know, Jesus said it. He said, for with love and kindness have I drawn thee. How many know that when we walk in the agape, the God kind of love, that we're going to draw people from the world into Christ. But we got to demonstrate it. We got to walk in it. You know, Brother John, we can't be moody. You know what I mean? Amen. Every time somebody say something to you, you snap. I don't feel good. Don't bother me. But that should be the attitude of the attributes of a born-again believer. We should always be walking in love. Now, I'm not saying that we don't make mistakes and things may happen sometimes we're under pressure. But if we realize that we made a mistake, we ought to acknowledge and repent and get it right. Because that's what love do. Love get things right. Love do things the right way. Amen? Now, the Bible said, and we know this familiar verse of Scripture, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe on him should not perish, but shall have everlasting life. So love is always give. Love gives, right? Love is not selfish. And then there's a scripture that talks about how that love is so powerful. The Bible said that love covers a multitude of sins. How do we know that when we're walking in love, we are covering one another? Amen? The Bible says we are many members, but one body. See, when we're walking in that agape, that God kind of love, we are covering one another. We won't gossip about one another. We won't mistreat one another. Amen? Why? Because love will cover his brother. Cover his sister. You know? We was talking about Sunday, Ephesians 5 and 20. We was talking about how that a man ought to love his wife like Christ loved the church. For the Bible said, no man yet hate his own flesh, but he nourishes it and he cherishes it and he takes care of it. Amen. And the Bible said that he, amen. Amen. That's what love does. Love protects. Love takes care of his wife. It don't mistreat his wife. It don't abuse his wife. So love is always covering. Love is always forgiving. Why? Because if I mistreat you, John, I'm mistreating myself. We might be many members, but one body. The body of Christ. And there's no such thing as a black church or white church. It's the body of Christ. And if the black Christian hate the white Christian, then he destroying the body. If the black Christian hate the white Christian, then he's destroying the body. So you can't really, amen, say that you are a Christian if we're hating one another. If there's division, if there's separation among us. Because there's no way you can say you love God and hate me. There's no way I can say I love God and mistreat you. Based upon the color of your skin, based upon how you look, based upon your economic status, or your education, or what you wear and what you drive, you can't say you're a Christian and you hate anybody. Because that's not God. The Bible specifically says God is love. He that loveth not knows not God. If we really want to kill a division in the church, if we really want to heal the church, then we got to start walking in love. Amen?
Amen.
We got to walk in it. That means I can't hate the Mexican. I can't hate the Arab. I can't hate no nationality or people. I got to pray for them. I got to pray for their salvation. Why? Because they are lost. You know, sometimes we look at people and we just don't like them because of what they do. But you know, sometimes people just don't know Jesus. How many of them that the Bible said one time we was, amen, that we were sinners. We was lost. We didn't know God. We didn't know his grace. We didn't know his love. So the Bible said while we was yet sinners, Christ died for us. And we got to have that same compassion for one another in the church. And for the world. Because the world is lost. The world don't know what love is. The world don't know the agape love of God. So that means we got to carry the love of God to a dying world. So that means that the love of God has to start within the church. And we carry it
to the world. Because Jesus said they're going to know you, that you are my disciples by what? By the love that we show one to another. So people are going to be able to identify who we are by the love that we show, by the agape, by the God kind of love that we show to one another. So, if I can't be gentle and loving to my brothers and sisters in Christ, then how am I going to get this world saved? If I can't get along with my own family and pray for them, and I know sometimes it's discord things happen in relationships, but still, we still ought to, we got to be the mature ones. We got to show love, and we got to pray for them. And I know sometimes in life you just got to go on and let everybody live their life. But still, we got to show love. We got to pray for our loved ones. We got to pray for our friends. Because people, amen, they need to see the love of God on the inside of us. Let me go ahead and read this. We're going to be here, and we're going to get out of here. I want to read this. We're going to go, we're still in Matthew. But I just want to read this right quick. And he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the perfecting of the saints. The word perfection there means to complete, to equip, to furnish. So he says, I give the fivefold ministry for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come into the unity of the faith, unto a perfect man, unto a perfect man. The word perfect here, I just said before, it's the word perfect here is the Greek word teleios. It's spelled T-E-L-I-O-S. It means to furnish. It means to mature. It means to grow mentally, spiritually, to come into a place of full age, a place of maturity. Amen? So the fivefold ministry is given to perfect us. It's until we all come into the unity of the faith. Unity, the word unity there means to come into a place of oneness. A place of fellowship. Do y'all understand that we as the body of Christ, we got to come into a place of oneness. We got to come into a place of fellowship. A place of unity. A place of oneness. The body is supposed to be one. The body is not separate. The Bible even tells us, how can the eye say to the hand, I have no need of you? How can the ear, say to the legs, I don't need you? But why? Because we're one body. Amen? Every member, amen, working together to create one body. So, the fivefold ministry is given to bring us into a place of union, a place of fellowship in the body of Christ. And so that means we need the apostle. That means we need the prophet. That means we need the teacher. That means we need the pastor. That means we need the evangelist. Why? Because it comes to mature us, to complete us, to bring us into a complete knowledge of who Christ is. And to a completeness and to a fullness of the God head. How many of you know we're supposed to be walking around with the fullness of the character of God in us? Number one, when we get born again, we receive the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We automatically receive the Godhead on the inside. We receive God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. He comes and lives on the inside. And that means that our life is supposed to be governed by the Holy Spirit and not by our intellect, not by our carnality, but by the leadership of the Holy Spirit. Let me hurry up because I need to get to my message here. So, do we all come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge? That word knowledge is the Greek word pignosis. It means to come into an intimate knowledge of who Christ is. So, do we all come into the unity of the faith? The unity of the faith. How many know that we're supposed to believe the same thing? Amen. We don't suppose, the church is not, everybody don't supposed to have their own opinion. Well, Pastor Barnes, this is what I believe. Pastor Barnes, this is what I think. No, amen. What we believe is supposed to be based upon the word of God. Paul said, let us be perfectly joined together. Let there be no divisions among us. Amen. We're supposed to be one in faith. One in unity, amen, in everything in the body of Christ. But the church is divided by doctrine. We're divided by belief. We're divided by denominationalism. And that's why the church can't be effective, because we're building our life upon the traditions of man. We're building our life upon our own ideas and concepts. But how do you know that if it don't line up with the word of God, we shouldn't even have it in our vocabulary. We shouldn't even be speaking it. Amen. The Bible says it should be line upon line and precept upon precept. Amen. So everything that we believe should be based upon the word of God. Somebody say oneness.
Oneness.
We're supposed to be of one faith. One belief system. You got some church folk believe God make you sin. So he can, you know, God make you poor. And then you got one group believe that God makes you wealthy, blessed, and healthy. That there's division. I'm trying to get, there's division in the church. There's no oneness. Some people think you don't have to come to church. Some people think, well, that's just religious, coming to church and having service. But you know the Bible said, forget not to assemble yourself together as some have. We're supposed to come together to encourage one another, to empower, to give one another insight and direction in the word of God. That's the purpose of ministry. So we need the fivefold ministry. You know, you can't be out there by yourself. God never intended for you to be. That's why he gave the fivefold ministry to perfect the church. So you know what that tells me? The church is out of order when it's just the pastor. That's functioning. The church is out of order when it's just the evangelist. But how do the church become complete? How do the church become whole when the fivefold ministry is functioning? Which the fivefold ministry represents the hand of God, which is the number five, and the number five represents the grace of God. And then, how do you know that we need the fivefold ministry so we can see the fullness of the grace of God, so we can come into the fullness of the knowledge of grace and the knowledge of who Christ is, amen? That's why the fivefold ministry is given to complete the church, to make the church whole, you know? So we won't be tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine that comes our way, amen? And me and somebody was talking about this week. We got a root. Amen. We got to root this. Amen. This legalism out the church. We got to root. Amen. This carnality out the church. You know. And we got to get the church to walking in union with the Spirit. Because when we all come into oneness with the Spirit, then the church is going to be effective. We're going to see the power of God flow. Do you know the Bible said, didn't the scripture say, James, that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways? That he shouldn't expect to receive anything from God? How do you know that when we have 10 different opinions in the church, then we're unstable? And we can't be effective. We can't see the power of God and his fullness. But we got to come to the same, amen, come to the point where we believe the same thing, where we speak the same thing concerning the word of God, amen, and not your opinion, but his word. That's what we're supposed to be speaking. So, it said for the perfecting of the saints, for the edifying of the body of Christ, We're supposed to edify, build up the church. That's the purpose of the fivefold ministry. Till we all come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So when the fivefold ministry is functioning in the church, it'll bring us into the fullness of God. The full stature, the full character, the full measure, the totality, the fullness of God. That's the purpose of the fivefold ministry. So that tells me something. When you don't have the fivefold ministry operating in your local church, something is missing. Because you need the prophet. You need the apostle.
Yes.
You need the evangelist in the church, because it's for the perfect. Till we all come into the knowledge of the fullness of Christ. And the reason I wanted to read that particular scripture, because we need to recognize that we are one. And that we're supposed to be thinking alike. That there should be no division. I should be jealous of Drenda. Drenda should be jealous of me. I should be jealous of John. God give you a new car, I shout with you.
Amen.
God give you a promotion, I shout with you. God bless your family and your home, I shout with you. Why? Because we're one. We're family. We're the family of God. You know?
Amen.
And so that comes to my point today. Is that we're supposed to walk in love. Let's read this. Now let's go to Matthew chapter 5, verse 43. For ye have heard that it had been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. Lord have mercy. Do y'all know many people in the church have that love-hate relationship? Well, if you don't do what I like, I don't want to talk to you. If you don't do it my way, we can't be friends. But listen to what Jesus said, because remember now, it's in red. For ye have heard that it had been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. But I say to you, love your enemy.
Yes.
Love your enemy. Love your enemy. Somebody said love.
Love.
This word love in the Greek is translated agapao. It's spelled A-G-A-P-A-O. It means to love in a social sense. To love in a social sense, in a moral sense. It also ties into the Greek word philia, which is spelled P-H-I-L-E-O. It means to show brotherly love. Philios is one of the Greek words for love, philia. It means to show brotherly love, to be kind to one another, to be gentle to one another. Y'all know Philadelphia, the state of Philadelphia in America, it's called the city of brotherly love. Of course, we ain't talking about the worldly love. We're talking about the God kind of love. That we're supposed to walk in filios. We're supposed to walk in that kind of love, that we show love one to another. That we fellowship. That we're kind, we're gentle to one another. How do you know we gotta get along first? How are we going to bring somebody else into the church and we don't get along? We got issues with one another in the church, in the body of Christ. I'm not speaking of us just in general in this church, but I'm just speaking of the body of Christ as a whole. You know? Because guess what? When you go into, we'll go there in just a minute. Let's finish reading this. Oh, goodness. Ye have heard that it had been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemy. Love your enemy. Love your enemy. when they mistreat you, when they talk about you. Love your enemies. Bless. Woo. Did y'all hear what he just said? He said, listen to this. He said, bless them that curse you. Bless them that curse you. The word bless means to speak well of, to pronounce the benediction, to provoke a blessing over. So he says, guess what? When they mistreat you, speak good about it. Love. Speak a blessing over their lives. So if you're a Christian, when somebody talks about you, you don't go gossiping about them. You bless them. You show benevolence. You show love. You show kindness. You show gentleness. You pray for them. That's our job. How many know they say, and I go keep going, I keep going back to the scripture. They'll know us by the love that we show to one another. Jesus said they'll know that you are my disciples by the love that you show one to another. So we are identified by our love, not by your preaching, not by casting out demons, not by healing the sick, not by raising the dead, but you are marked and you are known by the love that you show one to another. Amen. So love is a mark of a true Christian, not signs and miracles. The devil can cast out demons. At least he'll fool you. Amen. Because the Bible says Satan can't cast out Satan. Amen. Because the kingdom of Jesus told you, a kingdom divided can't stand. Whew. Sometimes we wonder why we ain't moving forward, because the church is divided. The kingdom is divided. That's sad. The church got to come together. We got to come together. We got to have one belief. Amen?
Amen.
You know?
Amen.
And it's got to be the word of God. God ain't asking for your philosophy. He ain't asking. He don't want your commentary or what you think. And Paul even told us, Paul said, be watchful, be careful of vain philosophers,
yes,
of man wisdom. Because he said it makes the word of God weak, powerless. Because we mix the word of God with our traditions. And God don't want your opinion. You know?
Jesus.
You know? We got now what we call liberal, what they call liberal theology. You can add what you want to add. You can say what you want to say. You can create your own commentary, your own idea and concept. But how do we know that we only supposed to speak the word of God?
Yes.
Amen? Ain't nothing, and I agree, ain't nothing wrong with studying history and background of the Bible. Amen. But history and background ain't the word. You need to know that for your own purpose. But you got to speak the word. You ain't hear Jesus sitting up there talking about their culture and quoting his culture, the background, amen, of the Jews. He was just preaching the unadulterated word of God. He was speaking deliverance. He was not trying to impress the people like the Pharisees.
Yes.
Y'all know what Jesus said about them Pharisees? So they stand in the temple, amen, praying that they may be seen. They fast with sad countenance and faces that they may be seen a man. And Jesus told them, guess what? You already got your reward. You want the praises of man more than the praises of God. So what's my point? Whatever we do, we got to do it with the right motive, the right heart. God, I just want your will. We sang that song, Jesus, I want to be more like you. Y'all remember that song we used to sing? Jesus, I just want to be more like you.
Yeah.
I just want to be more like him.
Amen.
I just want to walk in love. So he said, bless them, speak well of them that curse you. Ooh. Do good to them that hate you. Wow. I mean, no, that's not natural. Because by nature, if you hit me, I want to get you back. In your human nature.
Because Peter, 2 Peter said, we have received the nature of God. Because we're born of him. Mm-hmm. If you still got your old nature, then you're going to walk in hatred. You're going to walk in unforgiveness. You're going to walk in bitterness. Because you haven't received the transformation by the Spirit. I can't hate nobody if I wanted to. Because my new nature won't let me. You know? People can mistreat me and say things and do things, but you know what? I know I got to forgive. Amen. And that's my nature because I've been born again. If you find it hard to love, you need to go back to the altar.
Amen.
And ask God to help you. Because the Bible says in Romans, is it Romans 5 and 5, talks about how that the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. The love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. So this kind of love that I'm talking about is a supernatural love that is poured into us. It don't come from our human nature, but it comes from the Spirit of God on the inside of you. Because I know that it's impossible to love somebody that's hurt me. Without the agape, the God kind of love.
Yes.
You know. So, the scripture said, also tells us, examine yourself to see if you're found in the faith. Sometimes we got to stop and examine, look at our life and say, Lord, am I walking in love? Look at every part of your life. You know, and you have to. Toward my loved ones, toward my children, toward my grandchildren, toward my family, toward my sons, toward my daughters, toward your wife, toward your husband. Am I walking in forgiveness? Am I walking in love? Or am I walking in hatred, resentment, anger, and bitterness? If you are, that means you're not walking in the agape love of God. And I don't say this to condemn you.
Jesus.
I say this to tell you. That means we got to get in the presence of God. And we got to grow in love.
Amen.
We got to grow in love. How many know the Bible said we grow? Love is we growing in this thing.
Mm-hmm.
We becoming more like Christ. But the Bible said God is not marred. For whatever man sowed, that shall he also reap. So I want to make sure that I sow love. God told me years ago, he's the victor of your sow love, you'll reap love. If you sow hatred, you're going to reap hatred. If you sow bitterness, you're going to reap bitterness. How many know? Some people wonder, well, God, why am I reaping all of this bad stuff? Maybe because you sowed it. And so we got to examine ourselves. I didn't say condemn yourself. I say examine yourself. And to see where you're walking at. And then you got to say, Lord, help me.
That's right.
Help me to walk in this agape kind of love. Holy Spirit, pour this agape. Pour this God kind of love on the inside of me. You know? This unconditional love is supposed to be in the church. I meet Christian folks all the time. And I don't say this to be negative. I meet Christian folk. They got nice cars and nice jobs. And if you don't have the kind of job they have, they don't even want to talk to you.
Yeah, right.
They arrogant, they prideful, they self-righteous.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? If they're that way, they're not walking in the love of God. That's not love. In the love chapter in Corinthians chapter 13, said, love is not puffed up. Love is not vain. So you can't say you're a Christian and you walk around with your nose up in the air against your brother and sister.
That's right.
You know what? God can bless me with $1 million tomorrow. And he can give me a mansion on the hill and a bank full of money. But you know something? My love for my brothers and sisters is not going to change.
Amen.
My love is going to be the same.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
But you got Christians in the church that are so puffed up, so full of arrogance and pride, and the Bible said the Lord hate a proud look. You know, we don't supposed to be proud as opposed to being lifted up in pride. Yeah, we can be proud to say, I'm proud to say I'm a Christian. I'm proud to say I'm born again. I'm happy in that sense. But to be full of pride and arrogance to put myself above my brethren or my sisters, that ain't the love of God, and that ain't right. I don't look down on nobody. People might say, well, and I've seen Christian people do it. But let me tell you something, you better be careful how you mistreat people. Because the people that you mistreat might be the person that's going to have your blessing in the future. Because the Bible said God reign on the just as well as the unjust. Amen? So the Lord pull it down one and he set one up. So you better be careful. Don't mistreat nobody. Don't hurt nobody. Because you never know who God can use. That's why, you know what? I pray for that person that's on crack cocaine. I pray for that person that's strung out on drugs. I pray for that prostitute. I pray for that person that's lost. Why? Because you don't know. God can raise them up tomorrow.
Amen.
You know? That's why I pray for them. And I show love. Because you don't know what the future holds, brother and sister. So that's why we got to show love to one another. And basically what I'm trying to say tonight is this. Is that the love of God is that we love one another. You can't say you're a Christian and we're abusing one another. And I said that Sunday. We're mutilating the body. We're killing our own body. The church killing itself. Many times. With hatred, with jealousy, with bitterness. And I say again, with prejudice, with racism, with hatred in the church. And I know people don't like what I said. Martin Luther King said this. He said the church is one of the most racist places there is. And it shouldn't be that way. We're the body of Christ. It don't have nothing to do with race. It don't have nothing to do with color. It got everything to do with Jesus and with love.
That's right.
You know? And again, I say it. We can't say we're the church and hate nobody.
Amen.
Let me finish reading this. And I'm teaching on love for a reason. Because we got to root up all this stuff out of the church if we're going to be effective. People like to come to church and shout and dance and holler. Oh, Pastor, we need, amen. And I believe in God. I'm praying that God's going to bless us with a great praise team, a worship team. I'm believing God for that. I believe in worship. I believe in lifting up the name of Jesus. But the church also got to grow. The church also got to, amen, got to mature and come to a place where we're walking in love, where we're walking like Jesus walks. Amen?
Amen.
What good is it going to do for you to shout and you don't never change? And grow and mature. Got that same unforgiving heart you had 20 years ago. Somebody hurt you and you can't forgive them. Just imagine all we did to God and to Jesus, and he yet forgive us. And we can't forgive one another. Wow. How can you even hold that in your heart?
Jesus.
I can't hold that against nobody because I should have been in hell. But he became my substitute. He took my place. He died for me. He made me the righteousness of God.
Yes.
When I didn't deserve it. So for me not to love my brothers and sisters, it's a slap in the face. Wow.
Let's go here. We're going to get out of here. But I said we'll be out here by 8:30. And it's almost 8:30. He said, bless them that curse you. The word curse means to speak doom over. How many of we ain't got no business speaking doom and death over one another? We're supposed to only speak life over one another. John, do something to me and I curse you. God, I hope you get him. I hope you kill him. I hope you... People, Christian folk pray that stuff. Do y'all know that's a form of witchcraft? A form of sorcery? You speaking negative? You speaking death over somebody? You better watch it. When you throw that boomerang, it's coming back. Because what you sow, you're going to reap. So he said, bless those that curse you, that speak death and doom over you. Y'all remember what he told Abraham? He said, Abraham, when he made covenant to Abraham, he told Abraham, he said, Abraham, I'm going to bless those that bless you. I'm going to curse those that curse you.
That's right.
We ain't got to curse them. God said, I'm going to take care of them if they mistreat you.
That's right.
No, but all we got to do is pray. We don't have to retaliate. We don't have to fight in this battle. Like he told Moses, he said, Moses, stand still and see my salvation.
Yes.
Amen. Somebody mistreats you, don't worry about it. God gonna get them. He already said it. He told Abraham, I'm gonna bless those that bless you and curse those that curse you. So as a Christian, we have no business cursing nobody. We pray for them. We speak well of them. We pray for them. You know? That's supposed to be our nature. If you're born again. Isn't that right, LaWanda? Amen. He said, bless them that curse you. And we're going to get out of here in just a minute, y'all. We're going to get out of here. Bless them that curse you. Listen to what he says here. He said, not just speak well of them, but like, listen to this. Do good to them. He said, do good to them. I heard Jesse DuPlin say this. He said, sometimes you ought to invite your enemies out to dinner. I said, Jesse DuPlin, you crazy. That's a hard one to do. But amen. He answered, that's what he just said. He said, do good to them. Wow. Now that's heavy there. How many of you do good to somebody when they mistreat you? You know, family member make you mad. You don't want to have nothing to do with them. I mean, don't walk off from them. Do good to them. Bless them. Say, come on over to the house and eat dinner with me. Amen. Come on and fellowship with me. Because we ought to be showing love. That love is going to transform them. That love is going to change them. If I walk in hatred like they walking, then we both. The Bible said, how can the blind lead the blind? Both of us going to fall in the ditch.
That's right.
You know? So if both of us acting the light, we both going to end up in the same place. You know, I just said it this way, that this can represent hell. We both going to end up in the same place. The bottomless pit. We are both end up in the same place. Amen. How can the blind lead the blind? Both of us blind, we don't know where we going. But we acting just alike. You know? So we got to walk in love. What's up, man? Shoot. I've been hurt by some folk in the church, but I had to forgive them. Because you know what I found out? Them folk that did something to me later on, because I showed love and didn't hold no grudges and no hatred, some of them folks blessed me.
Amen.
Because I didn't let what they did to me affect my attitude. Now, it might have affected me for a minute, but I prayed and asked God to help me, and I learned how to forgive and walk in love. Mm-hmm. And that's what we got to pray. God, help me. Help me to love. Teach me to love. Help me, Lord. Because unforgiveness is not the nature of our daddy. Whew. And the Bible said in 1 Peter 1:23, we've been born again not of the corrupt seed, but of the incorruptible seed, which is the word of God, which lives and abides forever. So if we've been born again of the seed, of the agape seed, of the love seed, then we should be walking in the nature of love, in the nature of God. Amen. That's our nature. That's the way we should be living. That's the way we should be acting. Forgiving and love should be something that we're doing every single day. You know? Every single day. Let me hurry up. I'm going to get out of here in just a minute. Do good to them that hate you. Ooh, you hate me? And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Have you ever known somebody was using you, trying to use you? And you go, Lord, they must think I'm stupid. If I really told them that I knew it, and if I really treated them the way my flesh wanted me to treat them, amen, it wouldn't be a nice day. But the Bible says here, he says here, listen to what he says. Pray for them which despitefully use you. Despitefully use you. My God, what do that word despitefully use? You know, despitefully use you to slander, falsely accuse. My goodness. That despitefully use you to speak falsely of, to accuse. He said, man, pray for them when they lie. When they talk about you, you know you ain't did nothing. You know? Now, if they're telling the truth about you, then you got to repent. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. A lie is different from the truth.
That's
right. If you doing what they're saying, then you need to get on your knees and pray.
Yes.
And ask God, God, help me to love. God, help me to forgive. God, help me to be a better person. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Because the scripture said we can come to the throne of grace in the time of need to find help. So whenever I'm weak in, I can come to God and say, Father God, help me. Help me to love. Help me to forgive. You know? So that's why Paul said in Romans, he said, you are inexcusable, old man. Why? Because there's no excuse for you. Because you can get help when you need it. God is, isn't that interesting? God is available to you. You can go straight to the throne of God to get help. You ain't got to go through no preaching. You know? You can go straight to God through Jesus to get help in the time of need. You know? And I tell you, when you get this agape love in your heart, man, it'll change your life. Okay, let's get rid of here. Do good to them that hate you. Pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you. Ooh, Lord. Boy, they're going to talk about you. They're going to persecute you. Ooh. Listen to verse 45. I like this. When he said, do all that, pray for them. Pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you. Verse 45. That you may be. Listen to what this says. That ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. Ooh, my goodness. So when you walk in this kind of love, people are going to see that you are the children of your Father in heaven. That's how they're going to know that we're children of God. By our love. So that tells me without this love, you don't really have your identity. You don't know who you are if you're walking in hatred. You're ignorant of who you are when you're walking in hatred. Ooh, I know this hard. I'm digging up tombstones today. He said that ye may be children of your Father, which is in heaven.
For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and send rain on the just and on the unjust. Did y'all hear that? Woo. He sent rain on the just and on the unjust. For if ye love them which love you, if you love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans, and the publicans do the same. If ye salute your brother only, what do ye more than others? Do not even the publicans do the same? Do not even the publicans do so? In other words, Jesus said, the sinner, they love them that love them. They pray for them that bless them. But he said, I say to you, love those that hate you. Bless those that persecute you. Because this is how they gonna know that you are children of your Father which is in heaven. That's how they gonna identify you. By your love for one another. And listen to what he said. He said, I rain on the just as well as the unjust. Some people think they're blessed just because they got some money, just because they got a car. But the Bible says here, he'll bless the sinner just like he will the righteous. Don't be fooled because you got a bank full of money. And you're hefty. And you're not walking in love. That's a deception. Because God said, I'll bless, he said, I'll bless the just and the unjust the same. I'll rain blessings on both of them.
That's right.
So the unjust can be blessed and prosperous and on the way to hell. If they're not walking in love. Because remember this, you are not identified by your wealth and your money and your car and your house and your education and your degree. You are identified by your love.
Amen. Amen.
So if you think you're something because you got a big car and a big house, I got news for you. You can have all that in this heaven. Well, I'm blessed. I got a house. I got a car. I got a little money in my pocket. But you can't get along with nobody. You walk in hatred. You walk in bitterness. You walk in unforgiveness. People going to hell right from the church. And I know that's a hard task, but it's a real truth. And I'm telling you what Jesus said. This ain't nothing I'm preaching on my own. This is what the Bible said. People don't want to preach that stuff. They want to hear about Daniel and the lion thing, the Hebrew boys. They don't want development. They don't want growth. Because it hurt to grow, don't it? You know? Growing pains is a mess. But he said, even the publicans love those that love them. I like this last part, verse 48. He said, but be ye perfect. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect.
Amen.
How many of that perfect perfection there? Again, it's the same word, teleos. But the Bible said that love is the fulfillment of the law. Love is what makes you complete. Love is what makes you perfect. When you walk in the law of love, you're walking in perfection. Because you can't hate your neighbor. You won't steal. You won't lie. You won't commit adultery. You won't steal. You won't murder. Why? Because love is the perfection that God speaks about. He don't mean doing everything perfect. You know, he don't mean necessarily dotting every T and every I. He just means walking in love, that love. Perfect character. That's love. That's love. That's love. That's love. And y'all know what? I want to encourage you today. Let's walk in that God kind of love. It's a scripture, and I know y'all have read this many times in 1 John 4:18 and 19. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. Amen. Fear torments. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. How many know that he said, perfect love cast out all fear? When you're walking in love, you don't have to be afraid of nothing. That love will make you strong. That love will make you confident. That love will let you know that your God is going to provide, that your God is going to take care of you. Amen? 1 John 4:7. Dear friends, let us love one another. For love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and know God. Did you hear that? Dear friends, let us love one another. For love comes from God, and he that loveth not knows not God. Woo! Isn't that something? To be born of God. Woo! If you're born of God, how many know you know we are born of this word? That means when you see me, you see love. When you see me, you see God. Y'all remember Philip asked Jesus a question in the Gospels? Philip said to Jesus, Jesus, show us the Father. Jesus said to Philip, have you been so long a time with me? Do you not know that if you've seen me, you've seen the Father? You know, people want to see God, and the only way that they're going to see God is in us. Paul said that we're living epistles. We're the living Bible. You know, and sometimes the only life of a Christian that they're going to see is in you and I. So we got to become this living word. We got to become the Word made flesh. So when people see us, they see God. My goodness. And we're going to finish this up next week. Amen. At this time, we're going to get ready to dismiss. Anybody need prayer? We'll pray for you tonight. Anybody got an offering? Anybody got anything they want to give? They can put it in the basket. Right.